Witamy Państwa.
Welcome to the first episode of Republika Sztuki. I'm Marcin Bong.
Janusz Janowski.
O czym będziemy rozmawiać?
What will we be talking about? Obviously about art in its highest form. Am I right?
Mam rację.
I certainly hope so.
Janusz Janowski będzie naszym przewodnikiem.
Janusz Janowski will be our guide on this journey. He's a painter, an artist, also a musician, and let me add, the president of the Association of Polish Artists and Designers. Did I miss anything in terms of your titles?
Nie pominąłem niczego w tytułach.
No, but I can also say that I have a PhD in humanities, so maybe this will help me to guide our viewers on this road through art.
Przeprowadzanie wszystkich przez drogę.
And the road is very complicated. And complex, for what really is art? Art is not the matter of tastes, that's the first thing to say. Definitely not, and this is the first myth I hope we'll manage to debunk today.
No właśnie, bo sztuka towarzyszy człowiekowi od...
Art has been with humans forever, ever since the prehistoric times. But today I can take a canvas and a big bucket of paint and just splash it on there, then call it art, and even find a person who'd be willing to buy this piece for a lot of money. I think it wasn't like that back in the day.
Żeby kupić to dzieło sztuki. W dawnych czasach chyba tak nie było.
Wydaje mi się, że najlepiej zacząć od początku, czyli nawet przekroczyć tą granicę...
It wasn't, but I think we really ought to go back and start from scratch. So let's go back even before the times of ancient Greece, to the prehistoric era, to the Paleolithic. Today we judge the artifacts or cave wall paintings from that time to be art, but back then their creators had no such distinction for the actions they took. Acting and creating is the basis for understanding art, and it's worth remembering that when we talk about our times, when it turns out that the sole idea or concept can be art, or even a different type of action, for example eating, defecation or sleeping.
Przypisana właściwie innym sferom życia, jak każde inne działanie, sen na przykład.
Jest w tej chwili określane jako sztuka, natomiast...
These things are nowadays often called art, but according to the standards that humans set for art for thousands of years, they wouldn't be. But here is a different question. Would it be art to create a pair of shoes?
Z perspektywy narracji greckiej jest dlatego, że sztuka po grecku techne...
From the ancient Greek's perspective, yes, it would be. This comes from the fact that art in Greek was techne, so an action, a skill. As Aristotle would call it, a systematic disposition to realize intended actions. Such an action could be making a pair of shoes. There is intent, there is a goal to realize, so for the Greeks it was already grounds to call it art.
Strukturę nazywano sztuką w Grecji właśnie.
Grecy, czy jeszcze dawniejsi, twórcy...
Does that mean that for the ancient Greeks and even the people before them, such professions as goldsmiths, blacksmiths and painters were considered equal? Did they treat them the same as creators, artists?
Ludzie tak samo traktowani przez nich? Jako twórcy, artyści?
Też do końca nie możemy tego tak jednoznacznie określić, ale w podobny. Tworzyli przedmioty tylko... Musimy mieć świadomość, że...
Yes, in some way, yes. We can't say it's exactly the same, but they were all creators of some sorts. They crafted things, but they made the distinction between the crafting of usable items, for example spears and swords, which had their own decorations as well, but their main function wasn't connected with aesthetics or art. However, the creations of artists were meant to refer to some higher values, usually the concept of beauty. I would also like to stress one thing, which is may be known to experts, but rarely to most people, that the canon of portraying people included the cognitive content of philosophy of those times. What does it mean? It means that Greek artists, for example Polykleitos, included in their sculptures of humans their philosophical ways of perceiving harmony, like the golden ratio and the relations of numbers.
Najbardziej niezwykłe informacje dotyczące rozpoznania harmonii rzeczywistości, tak jak na przykład złoty podział, czy wszystkie inne elementy, liczby, które
ale
tworzyły rzeczywistość.
Ale już wchodzimy w bardzo skomplikowane terminy.
Yes, but we are diving a bit too much into details and very complicated themes, which we will perhaps touch upon in the next episodes when we focus on the ancient Greece itself. But I would like us to return to that very first question or statement we made. Art is not about tastes. We often hear that it's subjective, whether something is beautiful or not. Some people like one thing, some something different. You yourself are a doctor. doctor of history of art, so isn't it wrong to create some canons of beauty when it's such a fleeting concept?
Tworzenie jakichś kanonów, niby kanonów, a przecież to jest wszystko taka sprawa bardzo ulotna.
Rzeczywiście jest to sprawa ulotna i rzeczywiście tworzenie wiedzy na temat sztuki nie jest sprawą prostą i wcale nie znaczy, że mamy...
Indeed, it's a very fleeting concept and gathering knowledge about art is very difficult. There is no ultimate hidden theory which could very precisely describe the phenomenon of art. We don't have a theory which could precisely reveal and pinpoint the value of a certain piece of art or its importance to the human spirit and the humankind or civilization in general. However, under the slogan "art is about tastes" hides the lack of comprehension of art. In my opinion, it is important to stress that it's not about tastes, so in some way we could show people that art is also about comprehension and understanding, that it has some rational element in it which comes from the artist. The artist always has some cause and idea to his creation. Art critics have a task ahead of them to decipher the meaning of a piece of art.
Ten zamiar odszyfrować ten porządek.
Widzisz, jak ciebie słucham, Januszu, no to wszystko wygląda...
I listen to you and it all seems fairly clear, but there were some artists in the past which followed a completely different path than the one you just described. You say about a rational idea and a message that the artists wanted to convey, but how should we approach those painters, sculptors, who created under the influence of drugs on when they were drunk? We don't have to look far to find such examples. Our own Polish artist Witkacy, who would even write on his paintings three beers and ether, or two beers and peyote. There was no big plan there, but rather a creation in a moment of temporary elevation, so something very opposite to what you just said.
Zapominamy o tym, że ci artyści, zwłaszcza przywołany Witkacy, jest tu modelowym przykładem.
Only seemingly, all these artists, the mentioned Witkacy no different, had an idea beforehand. Their idea was to create something under the influence of some psychoactive drugs, so there was an intent before the ecstatic state. The final effect, very expressive and built on emotions, grew from the initial idea, which always has to be there, the idea to create something. So the fact that he'll be creating under the influence was just a unique way of doing it. To understand it better, we need to come back to the theory of art of ancient Greece, so to the division into two main descriptions of art, which came from two main philosophical trends. On one side, their realistic approach, talked about by Aristotle, that art is a systematic disposition to realize intended actions, and on the other side, the theory of idealism. It allowed ideas to be much more important, and at the same time, it threw reason out of the window. The idealistic doctrine also separates into two trends, opposite to each other, but originating from the same thought. So on one side, there is ultra-rationalism, of which examples we can find in the 20th century, the abstract art. Art which is based on a very concrete vision, a vision that is understandable to us only in our minds, as a concept. Let me stop you there for a second. The ancient Greeks would surely perceive abstract art as daub. Maybe more as decorum. The art I'm talking about, so idealistic but very rational, would probably be called decorum, since it would be connected to, for example, repeated geometrical figures or some decorations on Greek vases. I see, so like wavy lines, crosses, other decorations. Yes, but at the same time, in the idealistic doctrine, there is also the radically irrational branch, so the one which today is very popular in art. It's based on emotions, on a very strong sense of genius and inspiration coming from within. This type of artists usually argue that only upon freeing themselves of the rules and standards of their times, they can create something of real value.
Dopiero wówczas, poprzez pracę aktywną, emocjonalną, są w stanie stworzyć dzieło rzeczywiście wartościowe.